I brought Pippa on.
Pippa is the magician who directed this. Big word, sorry, Pippa. But Pippa, how was this whole experience? You're part of one of the eight creative leads at SeaChange Project, and this was a spectacular opportunity to bring a story to life in a new way, a new thing. How was it for you?
I mean, it was mind-blowing, and that's exactly what it is. It was, as a storyteller, to have the opportunity to work on a project like this, to work with a story like this, and to work with someone like Craig, and to have, you know, two characters, not just an incredible human character, but this unbelievable animal character, who was so beguiling and enchanting and really has won the hearts of the world. It was kind of a dream come true.
It feels that, I mean, when you look at the film, it doesn't feel as though you could even, the story just feels like it's such a natural monologue of a journey. It's you did such a beautiful job of seamlessly putting together so much work. It must, I mean, we don't even think of the logistics of, hold on, he's holding his breath and capturing this, or could you actually get the scene from here to there all the way through? How difficult was that? It sounds incredibly hard.
It is difficult, but bear in mind, this is what Craig, I mean, this is what my whole team does. Obviously, Craig's been doing it for much longer than I have, or some of the other younger people in our group. And Craig's been filming animals for 30 years, and he's been filming animals underwater for a lot of that time. And he's been holding his breath in the kelp forest since he was a child. So it is difficult, but he was out there every single day, and he just got led into this magical hidden world. Because of that, every single day, going in, focusing on one thing in a very almost scientific way.
Definitely. A scientist observes carefully and reports honestly what they see. And that's exactly what Craig does. Observes really carefully and reports, well, honestly, and documents what he sees and then shares the view. It's not good enough just to do it and, you know, enjoy it just for yourself, but it's sharing the view that really brings it full circle. And there are a lot of creatures following him. He wasn't just following them.
Can you touch on, because there's a bigger element, you know, the Octopus Teacher is one part of a bigger story that you're all working on, the great African sea forest. The conservation, the preservation purpose of this film. Could you talk a little bit about the bigger picture that many people may not be wary of?
Well, I think the first thing, and it's something that's really been drifting deeper and deeper into our minds in the last few years, is just to realize that kelp forests are one of the most important ecosystems on Earth. They're one of the most vulnerable ocean ecosystems on Earth. And I'm sure Sylvia, who I'm quite in awe of, to be in this on this phone call with you.
the way around.
But the amazing thing that very few people realize about kelp forests is they cover 25% of our coastline. They sequester enormous amounts of carbon. They contain biodiversity that is so great. It is as great as the rainforests that we have on land. And huge amounts of endemism as well, and endemic creatures or animals that you only find in those specific places. So, and the other thing, and this came out in a report last year, is when we look at what climate change is doing to our oceans, after shallow water corals, kelp forests and seagrasses are the most vulnerable ecosystems underwater. And no one's really talking about them.
So glad you are. And I'll do what I can as well. We need all the voices, including the dogs.
Exactly. Dogs and cats. And
I totally
humans,
agree.
Humans and octopuses.
How are the conservation efforts going down there? How is it, you know, because there's been a lot of threats from the black cloud of ocean mining and even rebranding. The kelp forest to the sea forest was a critical move, it felt.
And I feel like creating this persona for the Great African Sea Forest is something that I'm very happy to say. I think we've made a lot of progress there. And I look at kind of when I read newspaper articles now, people are referring to the Great African Sea Forest. It's got a heart now, and that's really exciting for us. And I think anyone who's seen the film and cares about the octopus cares about where she lives. And people have talked about how being in this world was like, you know, traveling to a different planet, and especially during COVID, to get out of your lounge and spend time in an enchanted forest I felt like that's really what we had to do. That was my goal as a filmmaker, was to just give people a hint of the feeling that you get when you're in that place. And Sylvia, I'm sure you must have had so many experiences that you just wish you could transmit that into people's minds and hearts.
There is no substitute for being there. I mean, truly. But the next best thing is to take people there vicariously, to show them, let them try to see what you see. And that's what you have achieved with this film, what Craig has achieved. And to get people to lift out of themselves and to maybe be inspired to go for themselves, go see for themselves. I think a picture is worth 1,000 words, but an experience has got to be worth 1,000 pictures at least. So getting people to get out of their room, off their chairs, and into the ocean, not as, you know, let's go kill something, but let's just go explore.
Yeah, and connect.
Imagine you are a sea creature. This is your home. It is your home. It is our home. This earth is our home. And we have been so good at consuming the earth. Humans, through our history, our prosperity has been brought about because we kill the trees. We cut the trees. Yeah. We eat the fish. We do this. But we have to, enough is not only enough, it's too much. We have to pull back. And the goal is to find a really enduring place for ourselves within the natural systems that keep us alive.
Exactly.
And we're at the point where for the first time we can see it. I mean, lucky us. We're the beneficiaries of all of what has gone before. And we still have a chance. We still have places like the Great Sea Forest. I mean, it's vulnerable, but it's not gone. There's still great white sharks. I can't believe people eat octopus or squid. I mean, I just can't imagine it. Or parrotfish, Will. In the coral reefs, these beautiful animals. And people go and they first thing they think is, I wonder how it tastes. And they worry about going into the ocean thinking that maybe the creatures there want to taste you. In fact, they're not. I mean, I feel really safe when I go into the ocean. I don't feel as if creatures want to harm me. They should be worried because we have a tendency to harm them. And we've got to take that childlike innocence of an openness, that sense of wonder that is inborn. It is still there. I've seen it recovered in people who are getting into the ocean in their 50s for the first time, putting on a mask and becoming children again, because they see they see the world again in a new way.
I really Paul Spazer hope spot, and we now have 134 hope spots around the world.
And how, more coming.
And more coming. Good. With the support of all the people on this call for Mission
Network of Hope.
Yeah, network. How is the implication of a film like this that Pippa's directed for this, in this specific Hope Spot region? How has it been amplified by other artists around the world, documentary filmmakers? Are you feeling that there's a bit of a movement? Pippa, are you getting bombarded by people wanting to tell their stories, or or complementing, you know, supporting what the, your style of filmmaking?
We've had a response that I could never have dreamed of, and an incredible generosity as well. The amount of fan art we've received, we've had incredible composers offering to let us use their music for any films that we produce in the future. So it does feel like there's something in this kind of storytelling that combines science and emotion, and you know, and that's what's really important, is you can't have the one without the other. It's about engaging heads and hearts together and putting it in a powerful story. That's how our brains work. It's how our brains worked for millennia. And people have responded to it. And we've been overwhelmed and deeply, deeply grateful and deeply encouraged and inspired, actually, that human beings are still in love with nature. That's what's, yeah, that's it. And I think you were talking, Sylvia, about how we've just rampantly consumed resources and taken from the earth in this very physical, mechanical sort of way. And it's been incredibly short-sighted, because what we don't realize is that our physical bodies and the cities that we build and the cars that we drive are a very small part of what makes us human. And to experience the fullness of our humanness, we need to be connected. And there's nothing that makes you feel more connected and more inspired than spending time in nature. And it's also important to recognize that we're incredibly privileged to be able to do that. And not everybody can.
One of the wonderful things I think about the film that you created was to show the connections, how everything in the forest is connected. And what seems like a tragedy for one is a gift for another. So when the octopus in the end is consumed by the pajama shark, it might seem like, you know, that's awful. Oh, what a tragic end. But it's a beginning of sustenance. It's a transformation of one life into another. And octopuses tend to, at least as far as we know, relatively short time. It may be some do, maybe some live longer than others, but at least for this species, it's about a year. It seems remarkably short for so much intelligence, so much engagement to just be there for a year. But then when I think about one of California's giant redwoods, maybe 2,000 years old, a lifetime for a human must seem remarkably short. What, they're only here for maybe 100 years? That's nothing. It's all about perspective. And I think your film really provides just this opportunity to kind of get out of yourself and see yourself as a part of this wonderful, you know, stream of life.
Yeah.
That we are the beneficiaries of all that has gone before, way back to the beginning of Earth itself. And we have the opportunity, this gift of time right now, to take what all that's gone before and give it to the next generation coming along.
Yeah.
And that really shines in your film, that you're like ambassadors. We're here a short time. Hey, here we are. Let's go splash in the ocean. Let's take it all in. Let's become the octopus. Let's be the great sea forest. Let's let our energy connect with all the rest. And then let's do what we can to, as Craig does with his son. You know, all right, it's your turn now. We're part of this stream. And instead of being sad when the octopus finally becomes part of the shark and part of the whole system surrounding it, it's the chemistry. It's the living chemistry of which we are not only a part of it, we're dependent on all of it. And what happens to any of it affects all of us. What we do or fail to do makes all the difference. But we have a chance. That's what your film really powerfully conveys, that this is our moment in time. Let's really seize this opportunity. Let's protect this forest. Let's give back. We've taken so much. Let's give back.
So Karina and Ross, when we were caught up with them originally, they were saying that this bombardment is spectacular and it's so needed, but you're all artists, and you know, Sylvia and the team on one side as scientists, and the marrying of the power of the art to tell the story that will become more magnetic. How are you seeing past the sort of, not distraction, but the bombardment of support into the next projects or the expansion on this story to make sure the resonance keeps going? How are you all managing that?
I think it's kind of a question that you'd have to ask each of us individually, but I think the answer for me, and I imagine from what I've seen from Craig and Swati and Yanis, and all of us, is just to keep going back into the ocean every day. Keep going back to the thing that makes you feel inspired and the thing that makes you feel connected. And as I said, we're so lucky that we can do that. And even if you can only spend an hour and you spend the rest of your day on your computer answering emails or being on Zoom, just that even if it's just half an hour, it just keeps you grounded in what's real and what you're trying to do. And really what we're trying to do is just keep telling these stories and protect the place that we've fallen in love with. And you can't do everything. So that's our focus. And we're going to do whatever we can. We're about to launch a big impact campaign based on the film. We're hopefully going to, the book should be journeying to countries all overseas very soon, which is very exciting. I think we kind of heard that recently. And starting to engage with stakeholders in South Africa about how to navigate the space. But really what we do is storytelling. And we'd like to support all the organizations around us that are doing the on-the-ground conservation. We have a science division that we want to start, which will be run by Dr. Yanis Lanschkoff, and we're going to carry on with our kind of daily exploration and trying to figure out as much as we can about that world, because that's where the storytelling comes from. That's why the marriage between the science and the emotion and the storytelling are so critical, because catch people's imaginations, you've got to take them inside the hidden lives of an animal that they just could never even have pictured until they've seen that photograph and read that story. So
Pippa, what's the name of the book and when is it coming out?
The book's called Sea Change: Primal Joy and the Art of Underwater Tracking. And it's already available on our website, but
I think I'll have to start ordering it up. Actually, Craig supplied a photograph for a book that I'm producing for National Geographic, a big ocean book that'll come out late this year, with a picture of the great sea forest and the octopus.
We'll definitely get you a book as quickly as we can, for sure. We would be so excited to do that.
You can trade books. You can do a book trade.
Yeah, exactly.
Sylvia, something you've always called out is a raise of arms for artists like Pippa and Craig, and you know they have eight in their team that are working tirelessly from all different forms of filmmaking. What does this do to you as a scientist? For this rally cry for other artists to tell stories in harmony with science. Are you finding that your Mission Blue is getting a lot more attention and support for this new form of storytelling and a need for it?
Well, I don't see it as either or. I've always seen that humans are just born explorers. They want to know. And that's how we have prospered through our civilization. We learn things and pass it along, but it's the combination of, call it art, if you will. It's how do we communicate? It's seeing beyond just facts and figures. It's what does it all mean if we can figure it out? Or it's that quest for trying to figure it out. How do we express what we see, what we feel, what we know, or what we want to know? So it's certainly not either or. We're to be a total human being, it's like this, science and art combined, however, whatever words you use.